So yeah, yesterday we were looking at the real space lattice. Today we will look at a slightly different view of the crystal lattice. Okay, most of you have done solid state physics one with reciprocal lattice, but let me not assume any familiarity. Okay, so I will start from a point where I will not assume any familiarity, and then going into the reciprocal lattice itself. Digression, okay? And that digression is about a mathematical tool transform. Now, again, I'm sure physics people are extremely familiar with Fourier transform and talk about might be known to them already. I request everyone to bear with me because there might be some you might not know, and I'll give a overview, slight overview of Fourier transform. This is because the Fourier transform turns out to be a very important tool, okay? In terms of X-ray diffraction and so on. Fourier transform is an extremely important tool. And how, when we view the crystal through X-rays, we don't see the real space lattice, but we actually see the Fourier transform of the real space lattice. Okay, so that's what I want to show today. So let's start with what exactly is a Fourier transform. Now, mathematically, one can define Fourier transform as a certain integral. Okay, so this is a continuous Fourier transform integral. So let me write this first and then I will explain. Okay, so what you see here is that there is a function in time. Okay, so this function in time could be, for example, a signal. It could be some song, it could be some music, etc., etc. It could be a sequence of fluctuations, for example, coming from your brain, from the neuronal firing, or it could be whatever it is. So what this integral is doing is that it is converting a function in time to a function in frequency. Okay? And this f tilde of omega is the function in frequency. And this is called the Fourier transform. So I'm Fourier transforming this function f of t into f tilde of omega, and t and omega are called Fourier pairs. Okay? So, right. Similarly, one can also do this for momentum and real space. So one can write f tilde of k is f of x e to the power minus I kx. Okay, and this I'm writing this as a 1D integral, but one can easily generalize this to multiple to higher dimensions. Okay, so this is a 1D Fourier transform. All right. So yeah, I was saying that this is also invertible. So if I take f of x, I want to reconstruct f of x from the Fourier transform, then I can do this easily by again doing this integral e to the power I kx dk. So notice that here there is an integral over x, there is an integral over k here, and instead of e to the power minus I kx, it's e to the power plus I kx. Okay, so this Fourier transform, there is also an inverse Fourier transform through which you can go back from frequency to time space. All right, so this is basically the mathematical definition of the Fourier transform, but what does it physically represent? Okay, so if I give you an f of t and do a Fourier transform on it, then I get an f tilde of omega. So what does it physically represent? Okay, so physically the mod of f tilde of omega represents the strength of the frequency omega in that signal, in the signal. So what I mean is that if the signal in time is actually a periodic function of frequency omega, then you know that there is only one frequency omega in that signal. All of the f tilde should be concentrated only at that particular frequency. Okay? So that is easily seen by doing the following. What I can do is I can take that f of t to be a sine function, sine omega t. Okay, let me call this capital omega. Let me just one second. So let me call this sine omega t. Okay, then we know that f tilde of omega, if you just use this formula, you'll basically get delta of omega minus omega. So what this is telling you is that this is a periodic function in time, okay, with frequency omega. This is time here. And what you get out of that is a Fourier transform, which is a delta function, which means if I plot this f tilde of omega as a function of omega, then only at the frequency omega, you see a delta function. At no other frequency do you get any finite f tilde of omega. Okay, so all of the strength is basically concentrated at capital omega, right? So now if I take another function, so let me clear this, clear all of this.
Sir, is it what we see in NMR spectroscopy, like the Fourier, the free induction decay, time-dependent free induction decay ultimately appears as a delta function in frequency?
That's correct. So if you have, if your decay is a completely periodic function, which it may not be. See, usually decays are not periodic functions, right? So decays are usually something like, it could be either an oscillatory decay, exponential decay, right? So a decay will not be a periodic function, and if it is not a periodic function, you will not get a single frequency. Okay, you will get multiple frequencies. So we'll talk about that. Just give me some time. I'll come back to periodic function, but decaying functions usually are spread over certain frequencies. So maybe NMR is not showing you exactly a Fourier transform, but maybe some other kind of a transform. See, there are many kinds of transforms in mathematics. For example, there is something called a Laplace transform. Okay. In the Laplace transform, instead of using e to the power minus I omega t, you actually use e to the power minus omega t. So the I is not there. And it turns out that the Laplace transform is not invertible. Okay. So it's the inverse of a Laplace transform is actually ill-defined. So, but let me not go into Laplace transform. There are other kinds of Henkel transforms, and so many kinds of integral transforms are there. Okay. And different transforms turn out to be important in different areas. But Fourier transform is a universally useful transform. It's extremely, extraordinarily useful. Okay, so that's what I wanted to introduce, and I wanted to also show you how important this Fourier transform is in the study of crystallography. Okay, so that's what I'm coming to know. So, but we can discuss this later. Okay, just let me know. We can discuss this later for in the context of NMR. Let me go and do this. Yeah, so if I have a function which is sine of omega t, then the Fourier transform of this is given by delta of omega minus capital omega. In fact, there is another term also, but let me ignore that. So what this is showing is that if you have a completely periodic function frequency, then only that particular frequency is picked up. Okay. So if you have any general function of time which is composed of multiple frequencies, then in general, you will have a frequency dependent function, which will show you at what frequency, what intensity do you have. Okay, so it will tell you the intensity of every frequency in the signal that you had passed in. So using this, you can easily see that you can convert, you can create, for example, high pass filters or low pass filters, where you say that, okay, I want to remove all the bass in my song, right? So then you will do a Fourier transform, remove all the low frequencies, and then reconstruct your signal once again using the Fourier transform. Okay, so what that will do is it will remove all the low frequencies, so all the bass is gone. Similarly, you can do this for treble also. So you can remove all the high frequencies, and so you can create band pass filters. Okay, and this can be done not just for songs but any kinds of signals, right? Now there is one more very interesting function which shows you the exact relation between the Fourier transformed function and the signal itself. Okay, and that function is a Gaussian function. So most of you are familiar with the Gaussian function. It arises in the study of simple harmonic oscillators and many other, in the central limit theorem. And again, this is a very useful function. So the Gaussian function, if I take it as f of x is e to the power minus pi x squared by sigma squared. Okay, now this function, if I plot this, then it turns out that it looks like this. It's an inverse bell-shaped curve. And the width of this function is of the order of sigma. Okay? So the sigma appearing here actually denotes the width of this function. Right? Now, it turns out that x and k, okay, k is basically p by h cross in quantum mechanics, or it's a wave number, so you can also call it 2 pi by lambda. So x and k are actually Fourier pairs. So which means that I can do a Fourier transform and write down a function in k space, and that looks like this: e to the power minus pi sigma squared k squared, and this I can rewrite as e to the power minus pi squared over into k by 1 by sigma whole squared. So which means that the width of this function is going to be the reciprocal of the width of the real space function, right? So if this was broad, then this is going to be narrow. So the width of this is going to be 1 by sigma, okay? So this is very interesting. What this is telling you is that if there is a function which is spread out in real space, then it's going to be very narrow in k space. Okay, so it's the same thing here also. This function, this sine function, is a spread out function in real space, and it's going to be extremely narrow. It's a delta function, in fact, in frequency space, right? So the Fourier pairs have this very interesting property that if a function is in one space, then in its conjugate space, it's going to be extremely narrow, okay, and vice versa. So do you see that there is some kind of a connection to Heisenberg's uncertainty relation here? That's a question. So do you
think sir, there is a connection.
There is a connection, right?
Yes, sir.
So remember, yes, all of this is completely classical.
Yes, sir. There is a same space, and there is also a coordinate space. So as the broad is coordinate space, the small is shape space extension. And if the shape space is large, then the coordinate space will be small. So delta S delta P is always constant. So there is a relation in the
correct. Correct. So in fact, if I write the Fourier transform, then f of p is actually given by of x e to the power minus I p x by h cross, okay? And you can show from very general principles of Fourier transform, the p and x, okay, because of this h cross, are actually delta p, they in fact obey this, okay? So this Heisenberg sensitivity principle is actually a very general property of the Fourier transforms, right? But it turns out we can also derive it from the non-commutativity of the operators. So we know that x and p in quantum mechanics don't commute, right? So x and p operators, they don't commute. And from this also one can derive this relation, but from Fourier transforms also one can derive this relation, okay? So it turns out, yeah? Yes, yes. Correct. Okay, so one thing is, if you look at the form of this, okay, the thing is, see, Laplace transform and other kinds of transforms, first of all, it's very hard to invert. Okay, that's one thing. The other thing is, if you look at the form of this this weight here, okay, so this is a function and this is the weight here, right? Or this is a phase factor. This phase factor, if you remember, is actually the wave function of a plane wave. Do you remember? So if you solve the free Schrodinger's equation, you actually get this as the plane wave. This as a solution. So what you're essentially doing is actually you're creating superpositions of plane waves, because the integral is basically a summation. Fx is the weight for that plane wave. Okay, so essentially this is like creating a wave packet in momentum space, and this is like if you invert this, then it's like creating a wave packet in real space. Okay, so what I'm saying is this is f tilde of p, and then this is f of x. If I write, then this is f tilde of p e to the power I p x by h cross. Okay, now remember, you can do this because in the Schrodinger's equation is actually linear in the wave function. Okay, so what we are essentially doing is that we are taking the solutions of the Schrodinger's equation, and then we are creating linear superpositions of those to create wave packets, and then looking at the spreads of the wave packets. So the natural transform that enters because of that is the Fourier transform. The reason is, if you look at, for example, the Laplace transform or the Henkel transform, then this phase factor is going to be either completely decaying. Okay, it's not going to be oscillatory. It's not going to be a plane wave. Right. So this is the reason I feel that the Fourier transform occupies a very special place. Okay. But that's not the, I mean, that's not the point that I wanted to make for this class. Okay. The only thing is that the Fourier transform is a very important transform. Right. And let me give you a little bit more introduction into where all it is used. So let me clear this. And the Fourier transform is, this is only for those who, well, let's see what happened. Oh, just 1 minute. The device seems to have got disconnected. Okay, so in general, for those of you who did not know this, the Fourier transform is actually useful in many different contexts. Okay, so one of the most well-known contexts is actually to solve differential equations. So it turns out that if you have a differential equation and you use the Fourier transform of the real space function and write down the differential equation in terms of the momentum space wave function, or momentum space function, then instead of a differential equation, you can convert this to an algebraic equation. Okay? So you can solve, for example, heat transfer equations, wave equations, even Schrodinger's equation, because that's also a differential equation. So you convert differential operators into algebraic operators, which is a very useful thing. Okay? And then you can use the inverse Fourier transform to go back to the real space solution. So this is one real use of Fourier transform. It's also used in signal processing, for example, the one that I showed you. It's used in image processing. Okay, so it's also in material science, especially, it's used to analyze strain, okay, and then fracture patterns. And finally, for what is relevant to this class, it's also useful to understand crystal structure. And that's what I want to bring up next. Okay? So it's the Fourier transform is useful to understand the crystal structure. Okay? So what is the use of this, or how is it useful? So let's see that. Okay. Now, to understand that, let's do one more special case of Fourier transform. So let's say I have a periodic function. Remember, we are dealing with crystals. So in crystals, atoms are placed in periodic positions. So we have to consider some kind of a periodic function. And we have to ask whether the Fourier transform that I defined in the previous slides, does it get more specialized for a periodic function? What exactly happens, right? So if I have a periodic function, let's say it's a function of time, okay, and I do a Fourier decomposition of this, then let me write this as this f tilde of omega e to the power I omega t. So notice that instead of writing in an integral, I wrote a summation over frequencies because I know the answer. Okay? What I know is that if I have a function of time which is periodic, which means f of t is f of t plus capital T. So this t is the time period. Okay. And if I write 2 pi by t, then that is omega naught. Let's say that that's the frequency of the signal. So I know that it's a periodic function, and that periodic function could have a very complicated form. It need not be a sine function. Okay? So it could have this kind of a form. It could even be this kind of a. Okay? So this is not a sine function or a cos function, right? So this is not a simple trigonometric function, but it's a periodic function. And the period of this is t. Okay? In such a case, if I have such a signal as a function of time, then it turns out that the integral that I had for the general Fourier transform reduces to a sum over frequencies. Okay? And the sum over frequencies is again a very special, the frequencies are very special. What you can show is that these frequencies are actually harmonics of the base frequency, omega naught. Okay? So omega has to be only integer times the omega naught. Right? And that you can show very simply by substituting f of t is equal to f of t plus capital T into this. What you will see is that sum over omega, f tilde of omega, e to the power I omega t plus capital T is the same as f tilde of omega, e to the power I omega t. Okay? And by taking this on the other side, you can show that if this has to be true for all time, then e to the power I omega capital T should be 1. Okay? And this basically means that omega times t is 2n pi, which implies that omega is 2n pi by t, which means n times omega naught. Okay? So the if you had a periodic function, then you can reduce it to a Fourier series, not a Fourier integral. And that Fourier series will have frequencies, only those frequencies which are integral multiples of the base frequency, okay, of the frequency for which this is periodic. Now, why is this relevant? Okay. So let's come back to the crystal once again. Okay. So in a crystal, atoms are placed in a periodic arrangement, atoms or molecules or whatever it is. Okay. So it's a periodic arrangement. But mathematically, I need a function. Okay. I need a function which is periodic. So not only that, I also need a function which interacts with electromagnetic radiation, that is X-rays. Okay. So what would be that function? What is such a function?
Charge density.
Charge density. Excellent. So the answer is charge density. So let me show you a simple image and that will make this clear. Give me one moment. So what you see here is a projection of sodium chloride, right? And here is the sodium and chlorine atoms shown here, and this is a planar projection. What you see on the right side is are actually contours of constant electron density. Okay, so remember, electron density is basically given by electron density rho of r is given by mod of psi of r whole squared. So if I look at the wave function of electrons and I take the mod psi squared, then what is drawn here are basically equal electron density contours. Sodium is here, sodium is here, sodium is here, and exactly the same patterns appear for every sodium, right? And you can see that if I translate along the sodium direction, I get exactly the same electron density. So in this FCC lattice, with the sodium chloride as the NaCl as the basis, if I do a translation along the lattice, I end up at the same function. Okay, so the rho of r or n of r, okay, let me call this n of r because that is the symbol used in solid state physics textbooks.
Sir.
Yeah.
Sir, can you please elaborate a little the term contour?
Okay, sure. Yeah. Yeah. So what is shown here are equal charge density contours. Let me elaborate on that. What we are saying here is the following. Let me consider a slightly different example. Okay. Let me consider a point charge Q. Right. And we know that the potential for a point charge Q is basically Q by 4 pi epsilon naught R. Do you agree?
Yes, yes, sir.
Yes. So if I go to a distance R, right, and then draw a circle around this with the center being at Q, what do I get? I get a surface, it's a sphere, right, of radius small r, and all the points on this sphere are basically having the same potential, right? It's an equipotential surface.
Yes, sir.
Okay. In other words, if I take a projection of this entire surface on a two-dimensional plane, I would get a contour. And that contour, in this case, as you're seeing this on the screen, it's a circle.
Okay.
Do you see that? Now, what I can do is I can place another charge Q. Okay? So let me take another charge Q at a large distance. And I would see again contours which are the same. But what would happen exactly in the center? Right? Exactly at the center, it'll add up. Right? Because the potentials, if both are positive, then they will add up. So if I had two different charges, then the potential or equipotential contours will be circles only very close to the charges. But in other places, they could look very different. They could look, for example, something like this, or something like this, or I don't exactly know, but they could look something like this. Okay. So this is exactly what is happening here. You see that there is a positive charge, there's a negative charge. And what one can do is that one can find out what is the charge density and figure out that, okay, along this particular contour, the charge density is exactly the same everywhere. If you take a different contour, then the charge density is the same on that contour everywhere, but it's different from the original contour, from the other contour. Okay? So does that make the concept of contours clear?
So basically, sir, it is a two-dimensional projection of the potential.
Exactly. Not exactly potential. See, here we are looking at charge density.
Okay.
So here, for example, if I want to get the charge density, then the charge density is only non-zero at two different points. It's a delta function. It's a delta function here and it's a delta function here. Okay. Here what I can do is I can find the wave function everywhere inside the crystal. Okay. And then for that wave function, I can take the mod psi squared and then multiply it by E minus E. Okay. So this is the probability density for electrons. And if I multiply it by the minus E, I get the charge density. Is that clear?
Yes. Yes, sir.
Yeah, and then what I can do is I can look at all the points in real space where the n of r takes exactly the same value and then take a projection along one of the crystal planes. Okay, that is when I would get this equi charge density contours. Okay, so this is
I agreed.
Okay, fine, good. So this is what equal charge density contours mean. And what this is showing is that the charge density is actually a periodic function inside the lattice. Okay, so that is the point that I wanted to make, that the charge density is actually a periodic function. Okay? Now comes the discussion of the Fourier transform. Okay, so let me just clear this. So something happens. Let me just open the sketchbook once. Yeah. Okay. So what we have learned is that the n of r function, but what is its period? We can ask the question. So the n of r is actually the same if you translate it by any lattice vector. And r is a lattice vector and it's given by na1 plus n1a1, let's say n2a2 plus n3a3, where n1, n2 and n3 are integers and the a1, a2, a3 vectors are the primitive lattice vectors. Okay, so if I translate by any lattice vector, I should get back exactly the same charge density, right? Now, what we discussed for the periodic functions comes into play here. So remember, if I had a periodic function in time, I can write it as omega times f tilde of omega e to the power I times omega t, okay? Where the omegas are basically n times omega naught. Okay, so let us see what would be the counterpart of this for the charge density, right? So n of r, let me write it as sum over some g vectors, okay, n g e to the power I g dot r, okay? let me see if the phase factor, yeah, that's correct. So let me write it this way. And then I want to figure out what are the G vectors. Or how are they related to the R vectors, right? So now, since we know that N of R is the same as N of R plus capital R, I can do exactly the same. I can apply this to this function. And what you can see very easily is e to the power I g dot capital R should be equal to 1. Okay? So this is the condition I get. Okay? Now, this condition means that for R equal to this, right, R is a lattice vector, I should get a g dot r which is 0 or 2n pi, right? So g dot r should become equal to 2n pi. Okay, so that's the condition I get. Now, given any general a1, a2, a3, it's not very easy to find, or it would not be very obvious to find what are the g vectors. But fortunately, a solution for this exists. Okay? And the solution is given by the superposition of three reciprocal lattice vectors. Okay, so let me give you what those vectors are: m1 b1, m2 b2, plus m3 b3. So this is the solution to this equation, where the b1, this most of you would have seen this, that if I write the primitive lattice vectors of the reciprocal lattice, then the b1 vector turns out to be 2 pi times a2 cross a3 divided by the triple product of a1, a2 and a3. Okay? Similarly, if I take b2, then that is 2 pi times a3 cross a1 again divided by the triple product. And similarly, B3 would be 2 pi A1 cross A2 by triple product. Okay, so where did we start and where did we end up? Okay. So we started from saying that the electron density is a periodic function. So this is the electron density. And the electron density being a periodic function can be decomposed or Fourier decomposed into the momentum space functions, but the momentum space functions are not arbitrary. You don't have intensity at arbitrary momenta. The intensity in the momentum space is non-zero only at linear superpositions of b1, b2, b3. Okay? And b1, b2, b3 are given by this particular formula. Now, what you can see is that if you were in 1D, then the b would basically be 2 pi by a. Okay, so you can see that this is saying that you have a reciprocal space, right? If A was the lattice parameter in real space, then 1 over A is the lattice parameter in reciprocal space. Okay, so instead of calling it momentum space, we call it reciprocal space. Okay, and if you also remember, the A1, A2, A3 was basically the volume of the parallelepiped in real space. Okay? So what you get here is all the reciprocal lattice vectors are actually orthogonal to A2, A3. So B1 is orthogonal to A2 and A3, and it's divided by the volume of the parallelepiped in real space, of the unit cell in real space. Okay? So this turns out to be a revelation in the sense that the G vector is actually a linear superposition of these three vectors. Okay? So now, why is this useful? Okay? So let's see. Let's see why is this useful. Okay, so to show that this is a really useful thing, okay, let me just write what we found. I will write this again, ng e to the power I g dot r. So what we found is that the n of r can be Fourier decomposed in terms of this e to the power I g dot r's, where the g vector is given by a linear combination of the three reciprocal lattice primitive vectors. So given this, now let's do the following. Okay, I want to do a small calculation. And the calculation is as follows. So I want to make X-rays incident on a crystal. Okay. So let X-rays be incident on a crystal. And the incident X-rays wave vector k. So it's a wave vector k. Now what will happen is that let's say this is the crystal and the X-ray is incident on this with a wave vector k, then what you would get is different directions. So you will get some k dash. Okay? So the outgoing X-rays will have some wave vector k dash, right? So what I want to do this calculation is the following. I want to find out something called F, which is the scattering amplitude. Now you will see what this will lead to. Okay. So I want to find something called a scattering amplitude, which is basically to the following. Let me write down and then I will tell you what it is. E to the power I k minus k dash dot r. Okay. What do you see here? First of all, this, if you see, is actually the phase difference between the incoming or between the incident and the scattered wave. Do all of you see this? So the incident wave and the scattered wave, they basically at any point r will have this phase difference, k dot r minus k dash dot r. And this is what will determine whether the incident wave and the scattered wave will constructively interfere or will destructively interfere. Isn't that right? So suppose k minus k dash were to be zero, or k minus k dash dot r were to be some integral multiple of 2 pi. Okay, then what would you get here? You would get e to the power 2 pi I, which would be 1. Okay, and then the f would be just an integral over the volume of n of r. Okay, so this is over a unit cell. Okay, so this is over all points in the crystal, but basically it is over n unit cells in a crystal, and n of r is periodic. So even if you take it over one unit cell, it's fine. Okay, so what do you see here? You see that the k minus k dash dot r is basically the phase difference. And if the phase difference is such that it's like a integral multiple of 2 pi, you will get constructive interference. Otherwise, if it is pi or half integral multiples of, odd multiples of pi, then you will get the phase difference e to the power I pi, e to the power 3 pi I, and so on, which will give you minus 1. Okay. So that will basically reduce the scattering amplitude. Okay. So to get a maximum scattering amplitude difference, which is maximum or which is even multiples of 2 pi. Okay. So basically what that means is that I can take the solution that I had found, okay, in the Fourier space and substitute that here. So what I would get is integral over r dv n g, this is sum over g, n g times e to the power I g dot r, and then e to the power I delta k, let me call this delta k, okay, and delta k dot r, okay, where this delta k is basically the difference between the scattered wave and the incident wave, right? So this means that I can take the sum over g out, ng, and then integral dv e to the power I g dot r, and e to the power minus I delta k dot r. And what is this integral? Does anybody know what is this integral?
Delta function.
It's a delta function integral, right? So what this means is that it's a three-dimensional delta function, correct. So what this means is that only when delta k is equal to the g vector, okay, that's when the f is a maximum. Correct? Do you agree with this?
Yes, sir.
Sir, can you repeat the last two or three lines?
Yeah, sure. So I was saying that if you look at this integral here, this integral is actually a delta function of delta k minus G vector. Okay, so what this is telling you is that this is naturally picking out delta k's which have to be equal to the G vector. Do you see that? So in other words, what we are saying is that the incident wave and the scattered wave can only differ by the G vector.
Yes, yes, sir, I understand.
Correct? So this is a very profound statement. This is saying that when you observe the outgoing waves, the scattered waves, and collect all of those waves, and then take the difference of the K vector of the outgoing waves with the incoming waves, you are actually discovering what are the G vectors of the crystal that you have. Remember, you have a real space crystal, right? And you are shining X-rays on the real space crystal. Okay? So when the X-rays are incident upon that, they will get scattered and they will come out in different directions. Now, wherever there is a constructive interference, only that direction you will have a non-zero intensity. Wherever there is a destructive interference, you will not see any X-rays scattered in that particular direction. So what that means is that if you pick up the intensity, if you make an intensity map around this crystal, you will be able to identify what are the K dash vectors X-rays have come out. And then you take a difference between the incident, the scattered wave vector and the incident wave vector. Then you have a list of all possible G values of the crystal. And what does that tell you? The G values are basically linear superpositions of B1, B2, B3. So by knowing all the G values, you can figure out what is B1, B2, B3. And by knowing what is B1, B2, B3, or A1, A2, A3. Okay? And A1, A2, A3 is a real space information. So what you're seeing here is actually a form of Bragg's law. Bragg's law that we all study in solid state physics is n lambda is d sine theta, right? Okay? And this comes from a constructive interference of X-rays from different planes, which are separated by distance d. Okay? So this is the picture that we learn, that this is Bragg's derivation of n lambda is d sine theta. Okay. Now what we will show is that the condition that we have written here, delta k is equal to g, which is what is giving you the f to be a maximum. Okay, that is actually related, or that is what will naturally give rise to this condition n lambda equal to d sine theta. Now why is this significant? This is significant because this, the derivation that Bragg gives for specular reflection or for X-ray reflection or diffraction is not a precise one.
Okay. Sir, isn't...
Yeah. Yeah, go on.
Theta is now.
Yeah.
Isn't this 2d sine theta equal to n lambda?
Thank you. Correct. You're right. Yeah, I had missed that. So thank you. Yeah, I was saying that, see, what Bragg assumes is that there are these layers in a crystal, crystal layers, and then the X-rays are getting reflected off these crystal layers or crystal planes, and they then constructively interfere, and that's when you get the n lambda equal to 2d sine theta condition. But are there true planes inside a crystal? Okay, which means that does X-ray get reflected everywhere from a crystal plane? No, right? It gets scattered actually from individual atoms. Or the electron density which is present inside a crystal is responsible for scattering the electromagnetic waves. And it's a coherent scattering, remember that. The X-rays do not lose any energy. Okay, it's only the K which goes to K dash, but the frequency doesn't change. Okay, so it's a coherent scattering, which is what gives you a constructive interference or a destructive interference. But this argument about crystal planes being the reflectors is actually a flawed argument. It's not a precise argument. What we will see is that the condition that we have just now derived for maximizing the scattering amplitude, which is delta k is equal to g, okay, is actually the same as n lambda equal to 2d sine theta. But it's very general, because what we will also see is that the d here is actually the distance between any two planes which have Miller indices HKL. Okay, so let's see how that works. But does everybody understand this this conclusion that we have got, that the difference between the outgoing wave vector and the incident wave vector is a reciprocal lattice vector G. It cannot be arbitrary. X-rays cannot be scattered in arbitrary directions. They can only be scattered in directions between the outgoing and the incident wave is capital G, okay, where G is a reciprocal lattice vector. Does everybody understand that? Is there anybody who doesn't?
Understood.
Okay. So I'm assuming that the default is understood, and if there is a doubt, then please let me know.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sir, what makes Bragg to consider diffraction as a reflection from the perpendicular planes of the crystal? Why Bragg consider the diffraction as a reflection?
See, it's a simplified model. Consisting of planes. Okay, crystal plane. So let's say I view the crystal from some particular direction, right? Then I can view the crystal not as individual atoms, but as a sequence of crystal planes or a family of crystal planes, which are separated by a distance d in that particular along some direction. That kind of a model of a crystal helps him to derive n lambda equal to 2d sine theta.
Okay.
So the thing is, it's just a model, but it's not it gives him the right answer, but the model is not really correct.
Okay.
Sir, yeah?
You can arrive at the correct answer through an incorrect model also. That's what this thing shows. But it's a simplified model. Okay.
Sir.
Okay.
Sir, you said that
yeah,
it is also quite understandable.
Sorry, I cannot hear you. Can you repeat
it
that?
It is also quite an understandable thing that every point of a plane cannot reflect, but the atomic positions will only scatter. So, before Bragg, Lowy derived an equation relating only the considering only the diffractions from individual atomic positions, not the planar the diffraction from plane. So why we consider Bragg's law as our pioneer, like not omitting the ideas of Lowy?
I am not so sure about the answer to your question. You are absolutely right that what we have derived is actually the Lowy condition. Okay, you are absolutely right, where he considered the diffraction from every point in the crystal or every atomic site in the crystal, or every lattice point in the crystal, but I am not sure why it's not called the Lowy law. Okay, the form in which he derived this probably is very useful for experimentalists, and maybe Lowy left it at this condition. And what was shown later, and we will also see this in the class, that the condition we have just now derived is actually equivalent to the Bragg's law. Okay, so I am not sure about the history of science here, but I'll figure out. Okay. So I didn't even know that Lowy had actually derived this even before Bragg had done. I didn't know that. So thanks for letting me know. I will find out more and let you know. Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Just give me 1 minute. I'm losing charge on the laptop. Let me just connect it to the charge. Alright. Yeah, so basically the condition that we have derived is the following: delta k is equal to g, where delta k is k dash minus k. And all that is saying is that there is an incoming vector k and there is a scattered vector k dash, the crystal. Okay. So that's the condition. Now let's do a small analysis of this particular condition. So let's write this k dash as k plus g. Okay. And let me consider, so let me take a g, okay, or let me write this as some g dash, okay, and then let me say g dash is some minus g. So remember that the g vector is basically, or let's say g dash is m1 b1 plus m2 b2 plus m3 b3. I can always consider a linear superposition where the m1 m2 m3 are negatives of m1 m2 m3. The g vector as minus m1 b1 and so on, okay? Which is minus of the g dash. You will see why we are doing this. Okay, so it's so I'll write this k vector minus g vector. This is a general statement. There is nothing special that has been assumed here. Okay. Now what this means is that I can take the modulus on both sides, okay, and square them. So the magnitude of both the vectors has to be the same, and if I do that, I will get mod k dash squared is equal to, this is basically k minus g dot k minus g, so I will get mod k squared plus mod g squared minus 2k dot g. Okay. So this is what I would get. Okay. So what that means is the following. Remember, I had said that this is coherent scattering. If it is coherent scattering, then it means that the mod k dash has to be equal to mod k. Okay, so the magnitude doesn't change, right? That's because the mod k is related to lambda, and lambda doesn't change. Okay, so the energy has not changed, which means that mod g squared has to be equal to 2k dot g. And this part, now I can, so let it remain at this stage. So I can write here k dot half g vector is actually mod g by 2 whole squared. Okay, I've written it in a slightly special way, okay, but that's the condition. So let us see what this leads us to. Okay. Now here I'm going to use two results. Okay. One result. In fact, you will see that in Kittel, in the problem set. So all of you must have got the resources directory, right? And some of you were asking for permission, so I made everyone an editor to that directory. So I'm sure everyone will be able to download. Okay. So do let me know, or Vinayak know, if you're not able to download anything from there. So Kittel's problem set has, in the first problem, what you're asked to do is the following. You're asked to show that the G vector is actually perpendicular to the vector HKL, okay, to the direction, to the plane HKL. Let me write it. So if I write the g vector as h times b1 plus k times b2 plus l times b3, okay? So notice here that I have brought in Miller indices. HKL are the Miller indices. And also notice that the g vector is a reciprocal vector. So what you are asked to show in problem 1 is the following, that the g vector is perpendicular to the plane defined by these Miller indices, HKL. Okay. So what that means is, if you remember, in real space, we had drawn this kind of a thing, okay, and we took the intercepts, took the reciprocals of the intercepts, then took the LCM, and then made them all integers, right? That was basically HKL, right? And what you're asked to show is that if you take the G vector, okay, then it's perpendicular to the plane defined by the Miller indices HKL, okay, where the G vector is defined in this way. And you will find it very easy, okay? It's not difficult at all. You can easily show this. So using this, and also using another part of that problem set, which is that the distance between the planes HKL, remember this is a family of planes, okay, family of planes which are parallel to HKL. Okay. So if I take this family of planes, then there must be some distance between the planes. Okay. So that distance D of HKL, okay, distance between the family of planes HKL to be equal to 2 pi times mod G vector times some integer n. Okay. N is an integer. Now this is very significant. This is telling you that the distance between two planes in real space, okay, with Miller indices HKL is given by 2 pi divided by the reciprocal lattice vector mod G, where the G vector is HB1 plus KB2 plus LB3. See the connection, see the deep connection between real space and K space. Okay. So this is very significant, because what this is telling you is that 2 pi by mod G is the distance between planes. And now you see how Bragg's law is coming up. Okay. So you've already got D here, you've already got N. Okay. So N and D are already in place. And using the Laue condition that we derived in the previous slide, we should be able to see N lambda equal to 2D sine theta. Okay. So let's see how that arises. So what we had derived was twice K dot G is mod G whole square. All right. So what that means is twice of, let's say this is 2 pi by lambda, and then mod G, and then sine theta. Now, why is there a sine theta? Okay. Not a cos theta. Normally A dot B is AB cos theta, right? But this is due to the way that it is defined. Okay. So the way it is defined is not with respect to the angle. Okay. So it's defined with respect to, if this is the normal to the plane, then this is actually theta. Okay. So in X-ray diffraction, this is theta. So this becomes pi by 2 minus theta. And that's why the cos theta becomes a sine theta. Okay. So that is equal to mod G squared. Now, if you use this result here, there is a 2 pi by mod G, right? So 2 pi by mod G is actually the distance between the planes, right? So let me use that. So I can take the lambda here, and what I get is basically twice of 2 pi by lambda times sine theta is mod G. But mod G is basically given by N 2 pi divided by the distance between the planes. Okay. So this implies if the 2 pi is cancelled on both sides, I will get 2 KL sine theta N lambda. Okay. So this is the Bragg's law. This is the usual Bragg's law that we all know. Now, what does this involve? Okay, so where did we start and where did we end up? So we started by saying that the X-rays get scattered from every point in the lattice. Now remember that there could be, yeah, any doubt?
Yes, sir, I could not follow from the HKL after DHKL.
Okay, okay. See, I have used two results here, okay? If you go to Kittel problem 1, which is a part of your assignment, right? Mm-hmm. What he asks you to derive is basically that the G vector defined as HB1 plus KB2 plus LB3 is perpendicular to the real space plane HKL. That's the first thing you are asked to derive. Okay. So okay. This is what you're asked to derive. And from that, you can also deduce that the distance between any two planes in the family of planes HKL is given by 2 pi by mod G times a number n. Okay. So okay. These two results I have used in this derivation. Okay.
Okay.
I have not proved these two results. These two results are part of your assignment. You understand?
Yeah.
So how did I use them? So I started with the Laue condition. So this is the Laue condition, which we had derived by starting from the scattering amplitude, from maximizing the scattering amplitude. And the 2k dot g equal to mod g squared means that since the k, if I decompose this, a dot b is ab cos theta, ab cos phi, let's say, where the phi is basically pi by 2 minus theta. Okay. And mod k is 2 pi by lambda. This is mod g and this is sine theta. Follow?
Yeah.
Yeah. So I have just used this. So I take mod g on this side and the d comes down. Right. So I then substitute that here.
Yeah.
Hmm? So that gives me 2d sine theta equal to n lambda. Okay. But this theta is very special because this theta is the angle that the incident k vector makes. Okay. Mm-hmm. With the plane. This plane, remember, is a family of planes HKL. This is not any arbitrary plane.
Okay. Yeah.
Huh? So if you take that family of planes HKL, then the k vector makes a certain angle with that, with the not with the normal, but with any vector on that particular plane. So in terms of that theta, you get 2d sine theta equal to n lambda. Okay.
Yeah.
So this is the general derivation of the Bragg's law, and it tells you how the real space and the Fourier space is related, first thing. It also tells you that when you look at the scattering of X-rays, what you're observing, the bright spots that you observe, are actually the G-vectors. Okay. So, but the G-vectors are what gives you the reciprocal lattice. So what do we mean by that? See, remember, A1, A2, A3 are the primitive lattice vectors of the real space, which means if I construct linear superpositions of A1, A2, A3 as N1, A1 plus N2, A2 plus N3, A3, then I can reconstruct the entire real space lattice. Similarly, if I take B1, B2, B3, then I can construct an entire reciprocal lattice and the G vectors are the reciprocal lattice vectors. And that is what the X-ray diffraction is telling us, is giving us. Does everybody see this? That the bright spots that come out of the X-ray diffraction pattern are the reciprocal lattice vectors. So you are trying to probe the real space, but you are getting out the reciprocal space. Okay? And from the reciprocal space, you would have to reconstruct back the real space. And that involves an inverse Fourier transform. So we started from the Fourier transform for this particular reason. Okay? That the Fourier transform is integral to crystallography. You're looking at a real space crystal structure, but you're getting out a reciprocal lattice structure. Okay? So I find this a really profound concept that somehow the X-rays are, you know, getting scattered only along the or the phase difference is picking out only the reciprocal lattice vector, and why should that be so fundamental? Okay, so that somebody else also asked that question, that why should the Fourier transform be the only one that determines the Heisenberg's uncertainty principle?
Hello.
Yeah. Any question?
Yes, sir. I have some how that G vector is related to only H, K, and L. That is not clear to me.
Okay, that's not clear. So you remember, if I give you A1, A2, A3.
Yeah.
You can construct B1, B2, B3 from there. Mm-hmm. Correct?
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, given B1, B2, B3, you can always construct a linear superposition HB1. Plus KB2 plus LB3, which you can call a G vector. L, remember, are the Miller indices and they are actually integers.
Yeah, but Miller indices, they are very specific. They cannot be arbitrary.
Exactly. So what I'm saying is that you will not get all the G vectors.
Okay.
For specific crystals, you will only get specific G vectors. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Hmm? So in that sense, you know, depending on what lattice you have, you will get these superpositions.
Okay.
Is that clear?
Yeah. And also HKL, they are dependent on the plane we are looking at.
HKL itself determines the plane that we are looking at. Yes.
Yeah.
HKL is the... So, but that is not obvious, right, when you start with this. Now, what I am saying is that if you observe a bright pattern in a certain direction, theta, then it tells you what is the distance between the planes perpendicular to that direction, right?
Okay.
Right? That dHKL that appears in the n lambda equal to d sin theta and n lambda equal to d sin theta, that d is actually d of HKL. Okay?
Okay.
But where does that come from? That comes from the Laue condition, which tells you that k dash minus k is actually a g vector. And that g vector is basically hb1 plus kb2 plus lb3.
Okay.
So, sorry, I didn't understand your question maybe.
Yeah, because we have different planes in a crystal. And hkl, they determine a set of planes which are parallel to each other.
Correct.
So, vector, we need to know all the combinations of hkl which are possible in a crystal.
Correct.
So how will you figure out that these are the only possible HKLs in a crystal?
Okay, maybe I said something wrong. I think, so given a set of primitive lattice vectors b1, b2, b3, the reciprocal lattice will contain all possible combinations of b1, b2, b3, which means HKL are actually all integers, are all possible integers. But are you saying that in any crystal you have a restricted set of HKLs?
Yeah, because the planes have, they are only finite number of planes, distinct planes. So there not be that HKL values should be some limited value.
I don't think so. I think the HKL values are not restricted. Okay. So let me just make a note of this. HKL are not restricted. This is my claim, okay? And I can see your point, okay? I'm totally sure about this, but my claim is that given any set of vectors b1, b2, b3 in the reciprocal lattice, any linear combination will give you a point in the reciprocal lattice, which means that all HKLs must be allowed. And what that tells me is that all possible Miller indices are allowed for a crystal, for a Breuil lattice.
Sir, I think mathematically, yes, it is allowed. What he is trying to say is...
I understand. For real crystals, if I take an FCC or a BCC...
Systematic absence comes in picture, then some HKL are restricted. So that is different issue, I think.
That's a different... No, that's the same issue. What he's saying is that some HKLs are probably not allowed. That's what he's saying. Isn't that right? Is this Krishna Kanaiya Tiwari?
Yeah.
So Krishna, this is what you are saying, right?
Yeah, this is what I am trying to say.
That some HKLs are not allowed, right? For certain lattices. But mathematically, this particular statement would allow all possible HKLs.
Mathematically, we can take any linear combination.
Yeah, so I am also getting a little bit confused here. Let me verify this. Yeah.
Sir.
Yes, go on.
Sir, I think there is a summation, there is a term in suffix g. That means this is a function. So mathematically, all the g values will be permitted. But in experimental, for certain g values, n g will be very large and will come at peak. Or for some g values, n g will be so small that we cannot see. But effectively, there are infinite number of g values. But we see only the factors which have large magnitude of n g, n suffix g.
Claiming now that n g will be zero for certain HKL values.
So not zero, not zero.
Or very small, or
will be large. Yeah.
Will be finite for other HKL values. Okay, I think this is probably the reconciliation of what Krishna is saying and what you're also saying, that mathematically, yes, all HKLs are allowed, but for those HKLs, I mean, for certain crystals, for example, the n of the G vector will turn out to be unmeasurable, or it will turn out to be zero. So Krishna, is this does this resolve your query?
Yeah.
Right? So I think this is probably the resolution.
Okay.
Good. Thanks, sir. Yeah.
Sir, I have a question. So, in the Black's law, 2D HL sin theta equals to n lambda. But in
sorry, we lost
that pattern. When we insert DHL plane, we don't get any second order peak. So here is n is only integer or a order. Hello.
Yeah, yeah. So you're asking me a question which is beyond my expertise. So you're asking me a question on X-ray diffraction and regarding the second order peak, is it?
Hello.
Yeah. Are you asking me about the second order peak?
Sir, I cannot hear you.
While measuring the X-ray, while getting the information in X-ray.
So when we say about diffraction,
yeah.
manually we eliminate the second order peak.
Yeah, yeah, go on. Yes, go on.
In normal diffraction, there are second order and third order peaks also. But in this, actually, we have got a solution almost like a diffraction. But actually, is the n signifies the diffraction order, or it is just integer? But we take it as one in experimental issues. If it is a second order, then using laser, we can get second order peaks also. But actually, in X-rays or high intensity, we cannot get the second order peaks. So, is that effectively an order number or some any arbitrary integer?
So, if I go back to the previous thing, if you remember what I had written there, so I'm not completely sure of the answer, but let me speculate. Okay. So, what I said was that the D of HKL is given by 2 pi by mod g vector times n, right? So what this is telling you is that if I take the family of planes, so if there is a, then the distance between them would be, let's say, d, they will be 2d and so on, okay, 3d and so on. Now I am not sure exactly where this second order peak and the third order peak comes from, but if it has to do with distance between the planes being 2D and 3D, then I can see that n is basically the order of the peak. But I would have to go back and figure out. Okay, so I'm not sure of the answer. Does anybody know the answer to this?
Sir, actually I know. It is, yes. While measuring a crystal in X-ray diffraction machine,
yeah,
there occurs many when X-ray is generated from some source. Mm-hmm. Like copper or molybdenum, there appears some second order or third order peaks, but using nickel prism or beryllium window, we eliminate those peaks. We only allow first order peaks to hit the crystal. So there are other order X-rays, but we eliminate.
Mm-hmm. No, that is true. But the question that he is asking is that does this n correspond to the order of the peak? Which means, suppose I use a particular n, okay, then I would get a certain answer. If I use a different n, let's say n equal to 2, I would get a different answer, right? If
yes,
I
sir.
Use the same theta, I would get a different answer. So, are you responding to that particular question? That is, does n correspond to the order of the peak?
Yes, sir. N corresponds to the order of the peak. N corresponds to the order of diffraction.
Sir, actually, in experiment, there are k alpha. Alpha, there are so many lines, but a question I am asking not only for the wavelength of the X-rays, different wavelength of the X-rays, but the order of the same wavelength X-rays.
So that means, let's say I choose a single monochromatic X-ray beam, okay, and which means very much related to the first Brillouin zone, but basically, first Brillouin zone is related to the half of the G vector in all the different directions, starting from any point in the reciprocal lattice. And clear that you start from any point in the reciprocal lattice, take all possible G vectors, The G vectors are basically the vectors connecting any point in the reciprocal space to all of its neighbors. Okay, so remember the G vector is n1 b1 plus n2 b2 plus n3 b3. Okay, so you're basically constructing linear superpositions of the primitive lattice vectors in the reciprocal space. And then if you take half of the G vector, that is actually giving you the perpendicular bisector. Okay? And that perpendicular bisector, you're then joining to get the Wigner site's primitive cell in the reciprocal space, which is the first Brillouin zone. Okay, so for those of you who have done solid state physics 1, you would remember that in 1D, the first Brillouin zone is basically given by minus pi by A to pi by A. Now that's what comes out from here. So if you take 1D, then this is just one vector, and B is basically 2 pi by A. Okay? So in 1D, B is 2 pi by A. So half of B is basically pi by A. So in one direction, you would get pi by A. In the other direction, you would get minus pi by A. And that is the first Brillouin zone. Okay, so this is the first Brillouin zone. Right? So in general, if you want to do this in 3D, then you take all the possible G vectors and you construct the Wigner site cell. Okay? So is this point clear to everyone? Is there anybody who does not understand this?
Sir?
Yes. Yes.
Sir, the shape of the Wigner site cell and the reciprocal space is the same, so, but the volume is different and the space is also different. So can we say the Wigner site cell is equivalent to reciprocal space?
No, no. So, okay, let me make the statement once again. See, the Wigner site cell you can construct in any space. You can construct it in real space also. You can construct it in reciprocal space also. So how do you construct it in real space? What you do is you take A1, A2, A3 in real space. These are the primitive lattice vectors. Take you connect all the neighbors to any given point. How do you construct neighboring vectors? You can construct neighboring vectors by doing linear superpositions of A1, A2, A3. Let me just clear this and show you what I'm saying. Okay, so what I'm saying is, in the real space, the primitive lattice vectors are A1, A2, A3. Okay? And in reciprocal space, the primitive lattice vectors are b1, b2, and b3. So here, if I want to take any particular point and call that the origin, okay, then the neighbors of this point will be described by r vector, which is n1 a1 plus n2 a2 plus n3 a3. Do you agree with this? Yeah, so if I take n1 as 1 and n2 as 0 and n3 as 0, then I get the first lattice point in the A1 direction. If I do this for n2, n2 is 1 and n1 is 0 and n3 is 0, then I get the first lattice point in the A2 direction, and so on, correct?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so now to construct the Wigner site cell here, what I do is I take half of R. Okay, and the half of R, I take it with all possible n1, n2, n3s and take the smallest possible volume that is bounded by all the half R's, and that gives me the Wigner site cell. Okay, this is exactly the same procedure of b1, b2, b3, and we are calling this the G vector here. Okay. So we can construct the Wigner site cell even in reciprocal space, and the claim is that the half G vector, if you take all the intersections of intersections of this, then basically the intersection of all of these half G vectors will give you the first Brillouin zone, which is the Wigner site cell in reciprocal space. Do you see this now?
Yes, sir.
All right. So it's already 5:27. So what we will do next time is that we will take certain specific lattices like cubic lattice or BCC lattice and so on, and then we will construct the reciprocal lattice, see how it looks like, and then we will come back to the point of why this first Brillouin zone and how is the X-ray diffraction connected to the construction of the first Brillouin zone. Okay, so we'll do this next time. Are there any more questions?
I have a question.
Yes, go on.
Yeah, you consider only coherent reflections, right? I mean, scattering here, right?
Exactly, yes.
Why don't we consider, like, there is a possibility of incoherent, or doesn't
Yes, happen. So absolutely right. There is definitely a possibility of incoherent reflection also. In fact, if you think of finite temperatures, you will also get phonons. And when photons scatter off the phonons, that is vibrating atoms, you would not get coherent reflection, okay, coherent diffraction. The reason you want to consider only coherent scattering is because only coherent scattering preserves the phase wave. Incoherent scattering will actually destroy the phase of the incoming wave. And if the phase information is destroyed, then you will not get interference effects. Is that clear? So only interference effects will give you the bright spots and the dark spots and so on, from which you can reconstruct the real space lattice. Okay, so because that is the basic aim, right? We want to reconstruct the real space lattice, and to reconstruct that we need the interference information, and the interference information is contained only if the phase is preserved. Okay, and that's why only coherent scattering is considered. But you're right, in a real situation, incoherent scattering also takes place. And the entire incoming intensity is not going to be found even if you add up all the scattered intensities. Some of it is going to get absorbed. You're also going to get other kinds of scatterings, definitely. I mean, for X-rays itself, you know that there are so many different kinds of scatterings. Okay, there's Compton scattering, and there's all kinds of scatterings are possible.
Okay.
Yeah. Any other question?
Hello.
Yes.
Yes, sir. In the first beginning of the class, you told about the Fourier pairs.
Hmm.
Is that any two variables can be?
No.
Fourier pairs.
Not any two variables. Yeah. No. So there are specific Fourier pairs, and only the Fourier pairs will have the uncertainty built into them.
Sir, every non-commutating pairs can be regarded as Fourier pairs.
The thing is, see, if you don't talk about quantum mechanics, even then you can talk about Fourier transform, right? So even in classical physics, you can have X and P.
Yeah.
Correct? Okay. But the X and P don't have a commutator, which is IH cross.
Yeah.
Okay. So there is, so do one thing. One thing called, okay, I don't remember this, but... See, when you measure something in real space, you would measure it, let's say, at certain x points. Okay? So yeah. What I'm saying is that, let's say, you are measuring something at some x points. Okay? So the information that you have in real space, right, is available with a certain resolution. Okay?
Yeah.
And it turns out that the Fourier space... if you look at the Fourier transform of this f tilde, the Fourier transform of f of x, then that will also have a certain resolution. Okay, and these two resolutions are actually connected through the Fourier transform and looks very similar to the uncertainty principle.
Okay.
But it's all classical. Okay.
Yeah.
There's nothing quantum mechanical about it. So all I'm trying to say is that Fourier transforms play a very important role in many different fields, okay? And the Fourier pairs have this kind of uncertainty built into them. But quantum mechanically, that plays a very important role in terms of measurements. So you cannot measure X and P simultaneously. Mm-hmm. And that's, they are non-commuted, I mean, they're not, they don't have a, they don't commute with each other. And that leads also to this kind of uncertainty relation. So I can pass on a certain a derivation of the uncertainty principle which starts from the commutation relation.
Yeah.
But the way Heisenberg presented it first was through the Fourier transform, actually.
Yeah.
So I will tell you about this. I mean, I don't remember this the relation between the two resolutions. It's a very famous thing, but I don't remember it right now.
Okay.
Sir?
Yes.
Sir, is there any other relation, any other relation except ET commutation relations or XP commutation relations or L theta commutation relation?
So for all non-commuting operators, as somebody said, you can have these uncertainty relations. So you can take any non-commuting set of operators and you can derive uncertainty relations for those, which basically is saying that because they don't commute with each other, you can't measure them simultaneously. That's all.
Okay.
Yeah. Sir, I have one question.
Yes.
Sir, this X and P, those the pairs that we are using the Fourier transform,
mm-hmm.
is it coming because of the symmetry relation? I mean, we know that translational symmetry and momentum is connected, right?
So correct.
Is it that connection?
Yes, in theory, the generator of translations is the momentum operator, right?
So
it's the generator the translational symmetry. If you look at the group of translations, the generators are actually the momentum operators, del by del x.
Is it because of that connection it's coming here in the Fourier? I mean, like, someone asked whether X and P, why those are the Fourier pairs.
Yeah. So you are now suggesting that if we take the symmetry or the group of translations, for example, translation as an operation, and we take the group of translations, then what is the generator for that? We can ask, right? And the generator for that group will become the Fourier particular operator. That's what you're suggesting, right?
Yes, sir. Is it so?
Yeah, I think that's the. I think that is the resolution. Yes.
Okay, thanks, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, I have a question.
Yeah.
At the beginning, when you were saying about the charge density,
mm-hmm.
You have mentioned that N of R is the electron density. But when we are looking at the lattice, there are ions attached to each lattice point, so there will be some nuclear charge too. So why are we saying that the charge density is only due to electron density and not for the nuclear charge density?
Okay, so all that I said was that if I look at the interaction, see, the interaction, first of all, of electromagnetic waves with a crystal is very complicated, okay? And what we are now saying is that you are right that we could look at the ionic charge density as well as the electronic density, but the ionic charge density is restricted to an extremely small volume, okay? And if I look at the scattering amplitude coming from that alone, then it's going to be extremely, extremely small. Remember that the charge density is non-zero almost everywhere in the crystal. Okay, so the scattering amplitude of the charge of the electron charge density is going to be far, far, far higher than the ionic charge density. That's what I believe.
Okay. So that's why we are neglecting the ionic part and we are taking only the electronic part.
That's correct. But the ions are playing a very important role because they're placed in a periodic fashion. And because they're placed in a periodic fashion, the electrons also arrange themselves in the lattice in a periodic fashion. Or in some sense, the wave function is itself not a periodic function, but a block function.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Sir, I could not hear the answer due to the question of Soumitra. So can you please repeat that?
Yeah, yeah. So I was just saying that, see, the ions also occupy the ionic charge density. If you look at the mathematical form of it, it's going to be almost like delta functions, because the ions are basically occupying an extremely tiny volume themselves. OK, Okay, but if you look at the electrons, they would be spread throughout the crystal because they are the ones that form the bonds, remember? Right, the bonding orbitals, antibonding orbitals, they are the ones that are responsible for all the bonding. Okay, so it's the electrons which are binding that entire crystal together. So the electron density is going to be non-zero throughout the crystal, and that would have a much higher scattering amplitude as compared to the ionic charge density. And that's why I believe that it's the ion, is the electron charge density that is considered for X-ray scattering. But I will confirm this, that the ionic charge density is really just a set of delta functions. So maybe that is not going to give a large scattering cross-section for X-rays. Are you able to hear
okay,
that?
Sir.
Yeah.
Okay.
Here are the valence electrons on the.
Well, the thing is, those are what are responsible mostly for the bonding. So the core electrons would again be confined very close to the ions, and they might not be participating much in the X-ray scattering. But this is something where I'm not completely sure.
Okay.
Okay. So my argument is based again on the what is creating the bonding. Okay. So the bonding is mostly created by the valence electrons, right? Find in all the interstitial spaces.
Yes.
Yeah. In fact, if you go through the book, that Ibach and Lutz book, then in the first chapter, they actually consider bonding. And they show you how the, what kind of bonding influences the cohesive energy and concepts like that. So maybe you can take a look at that also.
Okay, sir.
Hello.
Yeah.
Sir, I could not follow the derivation in which you flipped the sign of G vector, like K prime minus K is equal to G vector.
Okay. Yeah. So,
that part.
Wait one second. Yeah. So, see, what I wanted to get was simple. I chose a different. So, what I wanted to get was that k dot g and g squared, right? So, if I had taken the original derivation, I would have got a minus sign. That's all. Okay. But it's still a very general derivation because I can always flip the sign of k or I can flip the sign of g. See, what I had assumed initially was that k dash minus k is g vector, right? But this g vector includes all possible combinations of b1, b2, b3. Okay.
Yeah.
So I wanted to get a plus sign, right, to make it look nicer. That's all. But it doesn't mean that I have made any assumption or I made any approximation.
Okay.
So all I said is that if I can choose m1, m2, m3, I can also choose minus m1, minus m2, minus m3. Isn't it?
Yeah.
That's all. So it's just for aesthetics, nothing else.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So all I'm saying is that minus k dot g is of the order of g squared, or k dot g is of the order of g squared, are precisely the same statement. There is no difference between them.
Okay. Okay.
And you could see that in the construction of the Wigner site cell also. Because if you have a M1, B1, M1, M2, M3, you will also choose minus M1, minus M2, minus M3. Okay, you will also go in that particular direction. And then you will take the half bisector there also.
Yeah.
Okay, so my throat is gone and I would like to end here. Okay.
Yeah.
So